Hi everyone, welcome, good evening. Welcome to the Money Hour with Lakshmi. I am your host Priya Agrawal, and joining in with me today we have Chanchal Saxena from Team Lakshmi. And if you're tuning in for the first time, let me give you a little bit brief about Lakshmi. So Lakshmi is India's first financial platform exclusively for women. And in this episode of Money Hour, we are going to talk all about education loans. But before we start, for the people who have joined us live, do drop a hi in the comment section below so that we can interact with you, have an engaging session and learn together about education loans. All right. And in this session, I'm going to tell you what all we have lined up for today. So we are going to cover what is an education loan, what are the eligibility criteria, what's the difference between a domestic versus a foreign course in terms of education loan, what are the list of expenses that are covered, the features and the benefits of education loan, then the tax applications and the application process of how you can apply for that particular loan, and the repayment process, which is really important. So let's get started. And so education in terms of, as an Indian parent, it's very critical. As a goal, it's very critical. And however, while providing the best education is a priority, not many parents may actually be able to meet this goal. So this is because of many reasons. So firstly, it can be that they may not have planned their education beforehand, or as we see that the inflation rate is rising in this country, and especially in the education sector, we can see that there's around 10% inflation on a per year basis that we see on the education industry. So while ideally what a person should do is keep a separate education corpus and start early so that the power of compounding can work, but if there's a shortfall that you face, then an education loan can bridge the gap for you. So here's what you need to know. So education loan interest usually starts from a 6.85% per annum, and the loan tenures may go up to a 15-year period. And education loans may be offered for a higher education in both India and abroad. So the first step towards taking an education loan is to meet the eligibility criteria. So let's see, from Chanchal, why don't you explain our viewers that what is the eligibility criteria in terms of getting an education loan?
Definitely. Thank you so much, Priya. And hi, everyone. Welcome you all to yet another live. I hope you all are doing fine and you all are safe and happy at home. So coming to the question of the eligibility for our home loan, so there are various factors that a bank or a lending institution takes into consideration before disbursing your loan out, and even I think before approving your loan and your loan amount. So first is your nationality. Your nationality plays a very major role here. It doesn't really bother the banks that what kind of a nationality you hold, but the paperwork, the amounts, the and every other thing actually depends on this, and that's why it becomes a very crucial point of discussion. Next is your academic front, like what kind of a course you're enrolling into, what is the institute or the university that you are enrolled into, if you have gone for an abroad education, which country you're aiming for, and your you know, past performance as a student is also taken into consideration, because even the bank is investing in you, right? And they're locking up their amount for a period of time, so they need to ensure that the kid is bright, they are worthy of the amount that is being given to them. So these are a few things. And apart from that comes the formality of repayment. So here the banks consider your repayment capacity, which comprises of a lot of things, like your annual income. It could be your salary, or if you have a business, then your turnover, your family assets are taken into consideration. And a lot of banks provide loans against a collateral. These collateral could be your property papers, your you know, fixed deposit, it could be your insurances. But there are some banks which also provide you non-collateral based loans, but that is a different story altogether. We'll definitely talk about it later during our session, but these are the few things that the bank take into consideration and which makes you eligible to pursue your loan. So this is the story, and I think Priya, we should first discuss about the difference between the domestic and the foreign loan, and then I think we should you know, move ahead with our session on the various other topics that we discussed.
Sure. Definitely. So in terms of education loan, when we see that people may apply for courses in their country, especially in India, or in terms of foreign courses in foreign universities, so that is an education loan abroad that we consider. So in India, if we see the education loan, the courses that are covered may be from a nursery to class 12, which is also the schooling education that is covered in terms of education loan. Second may be the graduation and the post-graduation courses. So it may be a technical course, a professional diploma, professional or a diploma courses conducted by the various universities in terms which are approved by the UGC, AICT or by the government. So these courses are covered. Then in terms of the regular degree programs or the diploma courses that are approved by the Director General of the Civil Aviation, and the job-oriented courses that we see, or the professional courses in terms of the CFA, CIMA, or the CPA courses, or this loan specifically for a skill development course, which is there. So these are covered in terms of education loan in India. And talking about education, the courses that are covered in terms of abroad, so there are job-oriented courses, which is the professional and the technical courses, which people may go for an undergrad course as well as the postgrad course, or the other professional certifications that we are usually seeing these days, that the CIMA, CPA or the CFA. So these courses are also covered in this education loan. So Chanchu, do you have any thoughts on this?
Yeah, so there's one thing that I want to highlight over here, that when you are seeking for a loan, an education loan, and when you have to compare a domestic and an education loan, there are a few things that you will find different, and you shouldn't be worried about it, and you shouldn't have a question about it, because these are very, these things are quite unsaid. I mean, if you think of it practically, it makes a lot of sense to you. So for example, if you talk about the loan amount, see, banks offer you 100% coverage of your loan. If you want to seek a 20 lakh loan, it will provide you a 20 lakh loan if it's a education loan. But the amount that is given, it might be 20 lakh proper, considering that, you know, where you are going. So for example, if in India you decide to do a course and they know that this institute's fee does not include a lot of expenses, and it could be covered within say 15 lakh rupees, it will not give you anything over and above that. A little bit of here and there, which includes your hostel fees and other types of expenses. But if you look for a similar course abroad, the fee, first of all, would be very different. And the bank will also allow you to take that much amount of loan, because, see, one thing you have to see is the difference in your currency rates. Your one US dollar in today's time is somewhere around 80 rupees, like 79 to 82. It's always fluctuating between that price. So your currency difference also makes a huge impact on your loan value. Then when you go there, see, in India, you don't, there's no emphasis on insurances. As a student also, it doesn't really matter what kind of insurances you're holding in your home country itself. But when you go abroad for education, the first thing that they see is if you have insurances, and I believe it's applicable for most of the foreign education, any countries which provide that once you apply for your visa and you travel to that country, you need to have your own connections, like your own SIM card from that country. You need to have a bank account over there. You need to have your own insurances. So all these costs needs to be covered. And it might look very minimal in that country itself, but coming from a different country, it might be a little over your pocket. So these things are considered while giving you your loans, and hence the amount could be very different even for the same course. So that is one difference that I wanted to highlight between a domestic and a foreign education loan.
So that's lovely. And we have a question from Vinita. She's asking that you mentioned insurance. So what do you mean by insurance here, in terms of the student insurance, or is it the loan insurance that you're
talking? No, so this is a student insurance. So when you go abroad, I'm not sure you all are aware of this, but I think more like in US specifically, there the system doesn't work, that you know, you go to the hospital and you pay in cash or something and then it's sorted. Over there, insurance is a very very critical piece. The government ensures that every citizen over there has an insurance. So as a student, when you go there, if in case you, you know, God forbid you meet an accident or something, you need to have an insurance, because the cost of healthcare over there is very high. So that's why when you go there, you need to have an insurance for yourself. Now, even I have to check and verify if it's a pure life or a pure accident or a pure health insurance. But student insurance is something that you need to take when you go to a foreign country.
So I hope, Vinita, your question has been answered. And as we are talking about the difference between the domestic versus the foreign loan, so there are a few more things that we can consider here. So firstly is the processing fees. So the processing fees in terms of India and the education loan for abroad. So that may differ if you get a loan from a foreign bank also. So there might be a difference in the processing fees. Then there's the tax benefit. So if you are looking at loans directly from a foreign bank or university directly from there itself, so you may have the tax, you may not get the tax benefits entirely, because when you get an education loan from India, you have certain tax benefits, which we'll talk about in the further part of this session. Then the third is the currency fluctuation, as Chanchal mentioned. So this is a very important criteria, because if you take a loan from a foreign bank or anything like that, then there's a, you need to consider what all currency, like how the currency fluctuation is impacting your loan amount. Because if you will be transferring that particular amount of dollars to India to pay off the loans or something else is the criteria, then you need to see what is the rate of by which the Indian currency is depreciating as per the US dollars, and then figure out that how your amount, as the repayment amount, is impacted by that thing. And the third is the forex charges. So if you are taking a loan from a foreign bank or something for education abroad, then you need to consider the forex charges. Firstly, for paying that money to the university, there will be a forex charge, because there will be a difference in the currency. And second will be in terms of repayment, if you are making the payments back to your account, so then there again will be a foreign exchange transaction, so there may also imply a forex charge. So these are a few things which you can also consider while taking a loan for foreign education, basically. And now we'll see since we are talking on the expenses, so let's see what all expenses are covered in these education loans. So firstly, when we talk about it, so the basic thing is the tuition fees, which we usually get covered under the education loan. The second may be the hostel fees, which will get covered. And if you are getting a loan for abroad education, then the travel expenses in terms of the students' travel expenses are covered. Then, as we mentioned before, also the insurance expenses, so that is going to get covered in your loan itself. Then there's the cost of books or the equipments or anything that you need for your to support your education. That will also get covered. Then the cost of laptop. Sometimes the banks usually have different offers in terms of education loan. During the admission season, the banks may come out with different offers. So that may get your laptop expenses also covered in that particular loan. And then we have the other expenses, which are usually required in terms of getting an proper admission into an education, I would say a university. So that will get covered. So I think, Chanchal, we have covered enough about what is it, like what are the criteria, eligibility criteria. So let's look at what are the features and benefits of these education.
Definitely. I think that is something what our audience would have been waiting for so long to know. So there are a lot of features and benefits when it comes to an education loan, be it a domestic or a foreign education loan. First being that you can get a loan amount for up to rupees 1 crore, depending again on the various factors like where you're going, which course you're applying for, what is the fee that is required. So you can get a 1 crore rupee amount covered by your loans. You get a payment tenure of up to 15 years. So most of the banks give you a repayment tenure till 15 years. And you are free to repay before that. You are free to repay even before like 8 or 5 years. Nobody's going to stop you. But 15 years is something that is a great tenure that is provided to you, so you don't have to like worry or burden or stress upon your pockets for that matter. Then comes your education loan, as the fact in you know itself that you can take a loan to study either in your domestic country or your countries abroad. You don't have to stop yourself from, you know, growing, from upskilling yourself, and you can just pursue your dreams. And as Priya mentioned in the start of the session, that, you know, we want to pursue, we want to dream big, but just because of the funds, it becomes a hurdle for us. But education loan makes it easier for you there. Then various banks provide you doorstep services, like collection of documents and all those, you know, formalities are covered by these banks itself. There's two more things that are very interesting, that if you are a kid of a, you know, employee of a bank, or if you are a female candidate yourself, then you would get concessional interest rates on your loans. And I think that is really beautiful and something which is very useful for all of us here, because we all come under the female candidates. And I think everyone is promoting the Beti, you know, Beti Padhao, Beti Bachao movement. So that is one more thing here. Talking about the benefits, you have your tax benefits that you get for your education loan. Now, it's a little complicated, so let me just break it down easily for you. When you take an education loan, you have to repay the principal and the interest amount back. You can claim your deduction on the interest part of your loan for XYZ amount, because there's no maximum cap to it, for up to 8 years. So what this means is that suppose today you take a loan and you have to repay back 180,000 rupees, out of which 1 lakh is your principal and 80,000 is your interest amount. So every year, whatever interest amount you're paying out of that 80,000, you are free to claim a deduction on that entire amount of that interest that you're paying in that current financial year. And this you can do for the next 8 years. So from today, if you start repaying, till the next 8 years, you can do this. If you manage to repay your loans up to 5 years, then you are free to claim your deduction till then, but you can't make any deductions post that. If you fail to repay your loan before 8 years and you you know, have to repay your interest at the 9th year, you won't be allowed to take this deduction, because it's restricted to your 8 year period. Now, banks are not fools to give you no cap and, you know, just give you an interest amount deduction. So what they do is, when you take this loan, the bank is going to give you a statement which has the bifurcation of your principal amount and your interest amount. And when you are claiming this deduction while filing your ITR, you have to attach this document as a proof that, yes, this is my, you know, interest amount, and I'm not taking deductions over and above that. So one, that is a key feature and a benefit that comes with the education loan. And one last thing that does not really needs to be documented as a benefit, but if you have to think about it, when you have to pay for an education loan and suppose you're going abroad, it could cost you easily above, you know, at least above 18 lakhs if you have to go to a good country. And in a good country, if you're aiming for a good university, it's definitely going to cross your 25 to 28 lakh budget. Now, it might be very difficult for a, you know, middle class person to arrange for such kind of funds urgently at once, and hence education loan makes it easier to arrange for such kind of corpus. Yes, the interest rate is a little buggy, that yes, you have to pay something over and above your pocket, but what makes up to it is that at once you at least have your entire corpus to make payments. Some banks even disburse your loan entirely before you apply for your visa. So that is also, you know, that is also a good thing, because then your visa costs also get covered under that. So yeah, these were some of the key features and benefits. And you all must be wondering, like, how to, now we know about loans, we know about features, we know everything about it. How should we apply for these loans? What are the documents required? Now, if you have to apply for this loan, it is very easy. Go to any bank, go to any financial lending institution. You can even approach an approved charitable institute which provides a loan on education, and you can apply there for your education loan. Could be a domestic loan, could be a foreign education loan. There are various documents, however, required. Most of the documents are same, which you require to, need any other kind of a loan, because they all come in the same segment. But I'll still list out the documents and cover the other documents which are required to make your education loan process easier. First will be your admission form. Admission letter from the institute, which says that yes, your admission has been approved. It is it could come in various different sentences, but what the crux of it is that you have secured your seat in that university. So that admission letter you need to provide to your lending institution. Then comes your mark sheets of the previous education that you're pursuing. If you are going for a post grad, they might not ask for your school documents. They might as well, but for sure you have to give your graduation documents, because that was the last previous education that you had taken over. Then comes your personal documents, like your age proof, ID proof, address proof, your salary documents, your ITRs, your balance sheets, audited balance sheets, any income statement. If you have a business, then your turnover statements and all those things. And you will require a passport copy to show that yes, you need to show a visa copy, and you need to give a complete filled application form. Please make sure that you are not making any mistakes in your application forms. Whatever documents you are giving, they are correct. They show correct information. They are complete. Because if you fail to do so, your application could get stopped. It could get rejected. Wrong information can even lead to a fraud case on you, and we don't want anything like that to happen to you. So take care of these things, and your process should be very easier from there. So these are the things that you require for how to for applying for a loan, and these are the documents that are necessary. So why don't Priya, you tell everyone how, like, now you have your loan, okay, now you've taken your loan, now you have completed your education. Now what? How do you pay your loan back?
All right. But before that, whoever is live with us, just drop in the comment section below. So let us know and we can interact with it, with you all. And now let me explain you. But before that, I'd like to explain what is the loan disbursement process also before the repayment thing. So usually the banks, there are two types of disbursement. So firstly, it can be that the entire amount, as Chanchal explained, the bank can transfer it to your account before starting with the course. And second, there may be a possibility that the banks directly transfer the fees to the university on the basis of the payments as and when required. So if the first semester fees is required as of now, so the banks will transfer at this moment. And when the second semester fees will be required, the banks will directly transfer. So these are the disbursement types which usually we have in terms of education loan. And wouldn't be like a bank will transfer entirely the amount of education loan to your account without any prior knowledge or the fees the payment structure. And then one important thing here is that you need to list out a few things before signing the loan agreement. So as you applied for the loan and everything got finalized, so now you are eligible for a particular loan. You have been approved. So there's a loan document or an agreement that you need to sign with the bank. So there are a few things which you need to take care of and give a focus that you need to see what is the sanction amount, like what is the amount that you have applied for and what is the amount that you're actually getting it. So see that. And the other thing is the interest rate. What is the interest rate being offered to you? So is there a possibility that you can negotiate for a lower interest rate? Because if someone has a good education qualification background and has got an admit for a very good university, then on that basis and in terms of the credit score also, they can negotiate with the bank in terms of the interest rate being offered. And this negotiation can actually help them lowering the borrowing cost of the education loan. So this is the second thing. The other is the tenure and the other terms and conditions with the loan, that whether the interest rate is floating or is it a fixed interest rate. As we previously in the home loan live also we discussed that what is the fixed interest rate, what is the floating, how it depends and everything. So focus that. And also see what is the tenure of the loan. So if the tenure is a short, like a 7 to 8 year period, then your EMIs will be higher. So you need to decide beforehand only at what rate are you comfortable paying your EMIs, because it may be a possibility that you may not get that particular amount of job to, you know, repay your EMIs. So do the calculations beforehand and then you know, sign the loan document and the agreement with the bank. So these are the few things, because usually we see that people have taken a loan, but they face that they want to change something. So that might be a problem, as we see that they have to go back and forth with the office, and there might be a cases when things can't be changed. So it's better to do a research and check beforehand, and then rather than, you know, sulking after that we can't change things, right? So this is something which was related to that loan agreement. So now looking at the repayment process, so education loan is one of the only loans that gives you a moratorium period. So moratorium period is something which is a grace period where you don't have to repay the EMIs or you don't have to pay the loan. So the burden is, there's no immediate burden at that particular point of time. And the moratorium period consists of, firstly, your course duration period, which is, it may be a 2 year course. For example, you're going for an MBA. So it may be a 2 year program. And then after that course ends, you get that 6 to 12 months of grace period along with the loan so that you can find a particular job for yourself, settle down, and then your EMIs will start. So this is the moratorium period that you get, and this period of 6 to 12 months extra may differ from banks to banks, and this is also one of the criteria that you can look after while signing your loan agreement. So this is what we talked about, the moratorium period. So now when the moratorium period is over, that is like supposedly you have applied for an MBA, you have done the 2 year program, now the 1 year has also passed, now you are in a particular job, and then your EMI payment starts. So what you can do is you can firstly pay the EMI that is scheduled already. And if you are having a surplus amount, then you can also do the part repayment also. So you can make some lump sum payments along with your EMIs. Maybe even 5-10% or more than your EMIs will also be a great help to your loan amount, because it will help you in reducing your loan interest rates, and also you can get rid of that loan in a lesser duration of time. So these are some things which you need to take care of while repaying your education loan. So Chanchu, would you like to add anything to it?
Well, not to that, but because I think you have beautifully covered everything that someone would like to know about repayment, I would rather just want to add one more thing. As you mentioned about repayment process, that a lot of you who are going abroad for your foreign education, you might seek for a good amount of loan. And what you aim, like a basic aim of a person, is that if I'm going abroad, I'm going to work for a certain period of time after my course gets over, so I can accumulate some, corpus and pay back my loans. And then I would decide if I want to continue my residency here or I want to return to my home country. Now, if you're someone who's going to abroad for your education and you take up a loan and you complete your education, and might happen that you decide to come back because of XYZ reason, or you fail to, obtain a job over there and you have to come back to your country because your visa doesn't allow you to stay back, be very mindful that when that happens and you have to come back to your home country to collect your corpus, the financial burden on you increases. Why? Because when you aim to work there and earn money over there, you are earning higher, because like we mentioned, the currency rate. The currency rate makes the value of your money higher. But when you come back, so what you're earning there could be like a monthly 80,000 rupee, which over here would be in comparison just a 20 or 30,000. So your tenure will increase, your financial burden on you will increase. So be very much prepared. See, we can't say ki, this is this is inevitable. It's not in your hand. If you fail to obtain it, you don't plan to go and fail, right? But if, God forbid, something like this happens, be mentally prepared, you know, have a plan, be ready for yourself, so that if it happens, you are not stressing out on your pockets. Because I have known someone who, you know, who traveled. In fact, Priya, this is something very sad that happened. That person traveled to a country abroad. She did not fail to get a job there. She did get a job there, but the job was not paying her well, and the course that she did was very expensive, and that's why she had to sell off her own fixed deposits in the home country just to pay off that loan. And it was just sad because she wasn't ready for this kind of a scenario, that if this happens, then what? So if you are planning to take a loan of a very high corpus which does not have your collaterals ready for trade, do not, I won't say do not take a loan, I would say make a plan B. That's the right way of going about it. So yeah, that is what I had to add here.
Yeah. So this is usually a problem, as we have seen that it's very, these days it's very easy to get an education loan. All the banks are, after you get the admission and everything, a lot of banks or the agencies may approach you that we may give you a loan at this percent of interest rate. But a person needs to see that whether it is worth it or not, because taking a loan is a huge financial commitment, as we usually say. It impacts your financial future in some or the other way, because this loan is not there for 1 or 2 years. It's there for a longer tenure of the time, and you need to think a lot and think twice actually before making this decision. It's very good to see that, yeah, we will be able to fulfill our aspirations and dreams with this education loan, as all of us may not have that financial stability to pay for the education that we want. But before that also, you need to see that whether which course you are applying for, is it actually worth it? Are you going to get that benefits? What is the placements? What is the credibility of the institution per se? Because if you are paying such a hefty amount of money, it should be worth it, right? So see what has been the past placements records and what is the credibility of the institute. Is the course actually beneficial? Are you actually will you be actually benefited by that course? It shouldn't be your friends are doing it, so you should go for that particular course or a loan. So you need to see it for yourself and for your family also, because you may not get a higher amount of loan with just as you as the applicant. You need to have a co-applicant as well in terms of loans, and it shouldn't be the education loan burden is falling upon your parents or your co-borrower, because it hampers their financial situation as well as their credit score, and it may impact their financial futures as well. So it is not just about you, it's about the other people who are also related to you. So see, these are a lot of factors which we may ignore, or we may, might forget about considering. When we get an education, we are all very excited, we should go about it, or, let's get the education loan and get everything sorted. But you need to have this discussion with your family and sit down together and decide beforehand only what will be the criteria, how is the course, what is the repayment strategy. Plan everything beforehand. See that whether you will get that particular amount of package that you are expecting. No one is sure that they will get that particular amount as a job package or a salary, but they might have an expected idea of what the university companies offer. So have that in mind and see that whether you will be able to pay the EMIs that you have applied for or not. And then it shouldn't be like that you have that stress every time you get the salary, you have to pay a maximum amount of your money in terms of EMI, because that will start and you don't have to burden, you don't want to burden your parents in some or the other way. You want to be financially independent in the future and make your payments yourself. So keep everything in mind and then only decide that you should go for your education loan or not. So I think covered enough. And we have a question from Anuradha. She's saying that we need to pay simple interest on the availed loan even during the moratorium period. So EMIs would start after the moratorium. So Anuradha, you are partly correct. I would say that the EMI start after the moratorium period, that's definitely sure. But the simple interest gets accumulated on the interest, the loan amount, but you don't have to pay the interest during the moratorium. There might be some banks that may ask you to pay, but you can always negotiate on that, because during the course period and the grace period that is offered, a student may not be in that situation where they can, you know, pay the amount, because that is why they are taking an education loan, because they don't have a stable or a ongoing income. So I think that is, that depends upon the terms and conditions of the loan that you have taken. And yeah, a person don't have to pay the loans during the course period and everything. It only starts after the moratorium period ends. So Chanchal, do you have any thoughts?
No, you're absolutely right. The bank does, the bank or the institution does charge you simple interest during the moratorium period as well. But you are not mandated to pay it off during that period itself. If you don't wish to pay, it does get accumulated and you can start paying it off later. Although it's a choice for you that you pay during that period if you have that kind of money with you, or if you have already secured an internship or a job which is paying you good, so that your repayment burden like later on reduces. So that is a different aspect. But as Anuradha has mentioned something on simple interest, I wanted to highlight something that see, banks and lending institutions charge simple interest on your education loans, but there are certain private organizations which provide you education loan that also charges compound interest. If you calculate the difference, you end up paying more amount on compound interest, you know, which could be very less when it comes to a simple interest. And these are not very ethical activities, so be very mindful. See, I guess the amount that is disbursed as a loan would be very high, and maybe that is something that attracts you towards these organizations. But please be very mindful. Check what kind of an interest the lending institution is seeking from you, and don't be misled by the corpus that they're promising to pay you beforehand. But be mindful of what you have to then repay back, because that is important. Don't sit that, oh, they'll pay me 1 crore, so let me just be happy and take it. Because if you have to pay back 5 crore, that is when you'll realize that, oh, what did I do? So yeah, that's one thing I wanted to highlight. So Anuradha is saying, actually not a question, I meant we need to pay, since I have availed it for my daughter and all banks that I approach have the same rules. Not sure, Anuradha, how it's a rule, because like we mentioned, it's not mandatory for you to pay. You can always check again with the bank, and since you've mentioned it, even we'll check from our end and get back to you. But as what we are aware of, and you can like even search it on the internet, and I think Economic Times once covered this article on things you need to know before investing, before taking your first education loan, where it was clearly mentioned that you do not have to pay back your loans, pay back your EMIs right away. You can accumulate your simple interest and start paying it with your EMIs after your moratorium period gets over. So, but since you've said it, we'll definitely check it and get back to you. And yeah, I think that's all. Those are all the questions here we have.
Yeah. So if anyone is watching live with us, do shoot away all your questions. We'll be happy to answer them for you. And till the time, we're going to talk about something very interesting that I read. So it was about the education loan subsidy that the government is providing. So there's a scheme by the central government, which is specifically for people who belong to the economically weaker section of the society. So the government provides interest rate subsidy to them, and this is applicable only, they can avail this facility only once. So either for their undergrad courses, or for their I would say postgrad courses. So this is something which not many of us are aware of. But if you know someone who belongs to the economically weaker section of the society and has that dreams and aspirations to, you know, do something good, achieve something in life and be independent, so this scheme might be one of the things that may be helpful for them. to get that, you know, the benefit of getting an education loan at a lower cost and can help them achieve their dream. So this is something which you can research more about. And there is also that no repayment thing during the moratorium period which exists. So this remains the same here also.
Great. And since Priya, you have given such a beautiful insight on education loan, there's something that even I wanted to share with you guys. And that was the non-collateral loans that we talked about in the starting of the session. So as a collateral that I mentioned, it could be your insurances, could be your fixed deposit, could be your property papers that are taken as a security against the loan that is provided to you by banks or lending institutions. But there's also something known as a non-collateral loan or a collateral-free loan, which could be taken for up to a 7.5 lakh from some lenders, and it can also be up to like a 40 lakh for selective course and institutes from some selective lenders. So you can get these loans by various institutions, by various lenders. So if you're someone who doesn't have a collateral to provide, if you are someone who wants to take up such kind of a loan, please search about it more. If you need our help on the same, you can always reach out to us on our community, that is the Being Lakshmi community on Facebook. And you can also download our app, the Lakshmi app. It's available on Play Store and your App Store. And over there, you will find Priya and myself helping you out on every and any question that you have on money. And you can send us your questions there if you want to know more about the collateral free loans. And we'll be happy to guide you that from where you can get it, for how much amount it would be, and which for a certain course and institute, what would be the right approach of having that loan. So yeah, that is all.
You're beautifully explained by you, thank you. So the next topic, there's some a very common question that what if someone takes an education loan and then plans to go on a sabbatical? Like, there might be some reason that they have to go or plans to go for a sabbatical. Then there, what happens to the loan basically? So they have taken an education loan, they completed their education. Now they plan to go for a sabbatical. So how will that repayment structure will be? So this is usually, I'll explain. So this happens is when a person has taken a loan, the course duration ended and the moratorium period is around 6 to 12 months depending upon the bank that we mentioned. So even after the person plans to go on a sabbatical, the moratorium period won't get extended. It will be like as per the bank's restrictions and the agreement that you have signed. So if it's for a 6 month or a 12 month period, after that you have to start paying the EMI of the bank. Even if you don't work or you don't have that financial income or the cash flows with you, but you have to start paying the EMIs. You can't just default on that, because firstly the collateral is at stake, and secondly you need your co-applicant's credibility, and the the credit score and everything gets affected, and their financial situation also gets affected. So it would be ideal for you to plan everything beforehand and see what is your future prospect in terms of education if you are applying for it. So how do you plan to work? What is the strategy that you are thinking about and everything? So plan everything beforehand. And one more thing is, if you are really someone who is wanting to achieve their dreams and money is the hurdle or the obstacle that you are facing to, you know, achieve that particular goal, so it would be very much ideal for you to take that education loan and fulfill your dreams, and then you can repay it. Because since you have that particular interest and you are so passionate about doing something on your own, or you want to work somewhere, so and if money is stopping you, then you should definitely go for an education loan, and you should go for your future plans and everything.
Great. You know, adding to your point, Priya, there's also one more question that we received, which was, if I decide to discontinue my course after a set period of time, then how do I go about repaying my loans? So to that, the answer would be that you have your time till the structure of your course was originally planned. So as you decide to discontinue your course, go and search for a new job or arrange for your money and start paying it off immediately. Because if within that period that you have already structured your loan, the banks are not going to bother you much. But the time they get to know that you have discontinued your course, your collateral could be at stake, and we don't want that. Banks won't just sell off your collaterals, but obviously it will be a burden on you to either let go of your collateral or to free it by providing the by repaying the money that was promised. So the solution would be to either get a job immediately, or if you have left your course for some XYZ reason, then whatever your plan B was mentioned before, that if in case you fail to secure a job, execute it right away and start repaying your loan so that at least your financial burden on you stops. So that should be the right way to go about it. All right. I think we don't have a lot of more questions on education loan. So this would be the right time to make an announcement for all of you who's watching here. And in fact, this announcement is in parts of two. First is that we are going to conduct a live session on wills versus nominations. And if you want to be a part of this live session, if you yourself are an advocate who's well-versed with these concepts, a female advocate who's well-versed with these concepts, please feel free to join our community on Facebook and nominate yourself for this live. You will get a chance to feature on our community where we have more than 10,000 women with either me or Priya. And we'll be getting into a good discussion on why will is more important, or if nominee is enough, if nomination is enough to secure your financial assets. So if you want to be a part or want to attend this live session, join our community, the Being Lakshmi community on Facebook. And if you enjoy today's session, you enjoy our sessions in general, one, you can always put in the comments the topics you want us to cover next for you. Secondly, download our app, the Lakshmi app, from Google Play Store or the Apple App Store, and from there we'll be sending out one page key takeaways for all our sessions, and you can go there and read it. And not just that, we put out more interesting and more content which is finance related, which are topical, keep you updated with the market trends and everything. So download our app, join our community, and be a part of the Lakshmi squad.
And start taking charge of your own mom. That is the final objective that we want each and every woman to have.
Right. And all the non-female people watching this, if I have to say men who are watching this, you can, sorry, the community is restricted to females only, but you can always drop in your topics that you want us to cover if you really like our sessions and want to watch it more. Since Lakshmi page is a public page, and you are free to add in your comments.
That's lovely. Thank you for joining us, everyone. If you have any more questions, do drop in the comment section below and let us know that how you, whether you like the session or not, and what all topics you want us to cover. And one more thing, just to give you a little bit brief about a hint about the next session. So next session, we'll see you on Wednesday at 4 p.m. just like this. And we are going to cover everything about the car loans and the personal loans. So if you want some, if you are someone who's looking for more insights on these topics, do join us for on the next Wednesday at 4 p.m. We'll be happy to answer all your questions. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, everyone.